Welcome to St. Paul's Lutheran Church's weekly worship service. As always, we're broadcasting from beautiful Grand Island, Nebraska. The following Maundy Thursday worship service was recorded on Thursday, April 13th, 2017, at our 7 o'clock service. Please visit us online at www.stpaulsgi.com.
Our worship is ready to begin. We invite you into some quiet moments of silence. You may stand. You may face the back center aisle. Friends in Christ, in this Lenten season, we have heard our Lord's call to struggle against sin, death, and the devil, all that keeps us from loving God and each other. This is the struggle to which we were called at baptism. Within the community of the church, God never wearies of forgiving sin and giving the peace of reconciliation. On this night, let us confess our sin against God and our neighbor, and enter the celebration of the great 3 days, reconciled with God and with one another. I invite you to take a seat or to kneel as is comfortable for you for our prayer of confession, a time of silence. Most merciful God, we confess that we are captive to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. Amen. In the mercy of Almighty God, Jesus Christ was given to die for us, and for his sake, God forgives us all our sins. As a called and ordained minister of the Church of Christ, and by his authority, I therefore declare to you the entire forgiveness of all your sins, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Please stand. We have received the immeasurable riches of God's grace and mercy. Therefore, let us be reconciled with one another. The peace of the Lord be with you all. It is our joy to share that peace of Christ with one another. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. God, food of the poor, Christ, our bread, give us a taste of the tender bread from your creation's table, bread newly taken from your heart's oven, food that comforts and nourishes us, a loaf of community that makes us human, joined hand in hand, working and sharing. A warm loaf that makes us a family, sacrament of your body, your wounded people. Amen.
In the 13th chapter. Now before the festival of the Passover, Jesus knew that his hour had come to depart from this world and go to the Father. Having loved his own who were in this world, he loved them to the end. The devil had already put it into the heart of Judas, son of Simon Iscariot, to betray him. And during supper, Jesus, knowing that the Father had given all things into his hands, and that he had come from God and was going to God, got up from the table, took off his outer robe, and tied a towel around himself. Then he poured water into a basin and began to wash the disciples' feet and to wipe them with the towel that was tied around him. He came to Simon Peter, who said, "Lord, are you going to wash my feet?" Jesus answered, "You do not know what I am doing, but later you will understand." Peter said to him, "You will never wash my feet." Jesus answered, "Unless I wash you, you have no share with me." Simon Peter said to him, "Lord, not my feet only, but also my hands and my head." Jesus said to him, "One who has bathed does not need to wash except for the feet, but is entirely clean. And you are clean, though not all of you." For he knew who was to betray him. And for this reason, he said, "Not all of you are clean." After he had washed their feet, had put on his robe and returned to the table, he said to them, "Do you know what I have done to you? You call me teacher and Lord, and you are right, for that is what I am. So if I, your Lord and teacher, have washed your feet, you also ought to wash one another's feet. For I have set you an example, that you also should do as I have done to you. Very truly I tell you, servants are not greater than their master, nor are messengers greater than the one who sent them. If you know these things, you are blessed if you do them." Now the Son of Man has been glorified, and God has been glorified in him. If God has been glorified in him, God will also glorify him in himself, and will glorify him at once. Little children, I am with you only a little longer. You will look for me, and as I said to the Jews, so now I say to you, where I am going, you cannot come. I give you a new commandment, that you love one another. Just as I have loved you, you also should love one another. By this, everyone will know that you are my disciples, if you have love for one another. This is the living gospel of Jesus Christ. Please stand. We pray, Jesus, I wish you would let me wash your feet, since it was through walking about in me that you soiled them. I wish you would give me the task of wiping the stains from your feet, because it was my behavior that put them there. But where can I get the running water I need to wash your feet? If I have no water, at least I have tears. Amen. You may be seated.
Take now and eat.
In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Tonight, we also celebrate the First Communion of many of our children. We welcome you to the table to receive the wonderful gift of Christ in this meal for you. We'll share more on that later. Do observe the beautiful banners that each child has made that adorn the sanctuary as well. And thank you for inviting your family and friends to be with us tonight. It's a marvelous night for all of us. But to those who are visiting tonight, we invite you to join in throughout this holy sequence of services, actually just one service spread over three evenings, and then that celebration leads us into the great Easter celebration on Sunday morning. If you are not elsewhere, we invite you to be here with us. Tonight, as we reflect upon that holy meal in the upper room, two particular words come to my attention for reflection. And the words are simplicity and mystery. Simplicity and mystery. We're going to start with mystery first. The church, in its earliest beginning, before they created words like sacrament or words like Holy Communion or the Eucharist, they called this holy meal a mystery. And by calling it a mystery, they didn't mean something to be solved or figured out. They were talking about mystery with a capital M, God. The God that's beyond our comprehension, beyond our grasp. That we experience God as a gift of His presence, His grace. And the early church called that a mystery that we experience. We don't fathom it fully. We don't resolve it. We don't figure it out. We simply experience the beauty of it and know that God is God with love for us. And He is full of grace and truth. That's how John described the presence of God coming to us in the beautiful poetry that opens his gospel. He said, long ago, the Word became flesh, and Jesus of Nazareth became enfleshed, that we might see God dwelling with us, and that we might behold the glory of God who dwells with us, and that glory is filled with His grace and truth. And as we come to the Holy Supper, this Christ becomes enfleshed again. He invites us to eat His body and drink His blood, to use His words from John 6. And we partake of Christ, and He becomes enfleshed in us. And we then become Christ for the world, the body of Christ, given and poured out in love for the world. The church called this a great mystery. Let's talk about mystery. And let's start right where I'm standing in this spot. Start with me. I'm going to start with my own experience with the Holy Meal. And I invite you to bring your experience to the table as well. One of the great challenges pastors have when it comes to worship is how to do two separate things in the same moment. How to pull that off. And what I'm talking about is these two separate things. Leading worship, but also in our own personal way, worshiping. They sound like the same, but they really are two separate things. And very hard, very challenging to pull off in the same moment. Leading worship. I must be conscious, must be attentive to the whole assembly and how they are experiencing worship. I must be attentive to leading so people can follow. I must be attentive to what's coming next. Now, in personal worship, I can get caught up in a moment. I can linger in a moment. I can follow wherever the Spirit may lead me. That is your experience when you're worshiping. If everyone goes this way and you go that way, no one notices. in the spirit of your worship or thoughts. But if I at the altar suddenly get just enveloped in a moment of worship with God, linger in that moment, forgetting about all of you, you might look at me and say, "What happened? What's going on up there?" I've been known to forget the choir on occasion. That's happened here. They forgive me. I haven't done it here yet, but I've been known to forget the Lord's Prayer. Caught up in a moment of worship, my own worship. And if I do that on Easter Sunday, you're going to look at me and not say, "Oh, it's just the pastor lingering in worship with God." You're not going to say that. You're going to say, "Oh, he's getting old. He's forgetful." Pulling off these two separate things, it's a challenge. Over the years, and it comes to the Lord's table now, over the years I have found ways in which to weave my own worship into the leading of worship. And one of the places that happens best for me is at the time of celebrating the Lord's Supper. Now, the ushers come forward and are taking up the offering, and I'm preparing the table, and I am being pulled into a presence of God. I am mindful that long ago, our Lord's disciples were charged with preparing the table, the room for the Passover meal. Now, that was quite a preparation if you know anything about a Passover meal. And here it's a very simple table we set, but already being led into that experience of God's presence. And then comes the great Thanksgiving and the beauty of the liturgy there with its rhythm of language and song and chant, leading me deeper into that presence, that mystery of God. And then comes a moment that I hardly know how to describe it to you exactly. A moment in which I have the honor of saying the very same words that Jesus himself said that very first time in the upper room. Oh, what a privilege. Oh, what a holy moment. "This is my body given for you." And lifting the cup, "This is my blood shed for you." Beautiful, beautiful words that I am blessed to say. A deeply worshipful moment. A moment in which really the clocks on these walls just stop. A moment of eternity begins. It's past and present and future all fused into a moment of God's presence, his eternal presence. Past, the upper room. Present, this room where Christ is present for us. Future, the foretaste of a feast yet to come. We capture that in the liturgy sometimes with the words, "Christ has died, Christ has risen, Christ will come again." Well, it's one of the places I experience my own worship in those moments. It doesn't stop there, however. The deacons, the pastors, we come forward to share Christ's body and blood with all of you. And that mystery of God's presence continues to unfold. Tonight we have many people. This morning in the chapel, a much smaller crowd. Whether it's small or many, it is a wonderful experience, this flow of God's people at the table of the Lord. Young children, old adults, rich, poor, people hurting, people on top of things. Every manner of people. All being drawn into the oneness of God, this body of Christ, we say. I sometimes have the feeling that as I commune, folks, an angel or two slips right in there, and I'm unaware of it. They decide, you know, to leave the table above and say, "I think I'll commune with the folks at St. Paul's tonight." Or a saint or two who have gone before us. There's really just one table above and below, that is God's table. I've learned along the way, with the communing, again to weave a moment of my own worship into that experience. You might want to try it out in your own way. I've learned to weave into that distribution where again and again we keep saying and saying, the body of Christ given for you or the blood of Christ shed for you. I've learned to weave into those moments what I call micro prayers, quick flash prayers. It's like, boom, that's all the time I have, you know, before the next person. But to squeeze in that moment a micro prayer. Prayer for the, each of the people I commune. You've been prayed for many times, many times here at the Lord's table. It's part of that mystery of the presence of God that transforms us to quit making all the distinctions we make among people and to experience what it means to know the gentle love of God that makes us one body. Well, that experience of the mystery of God continues beyond this table. It takes us through those doors out into the world. We quickly end the communion service with the words, "Go in peace and serve the Lord." This probably is the most challenging part of worship for me, to take that experience into the world out there. You probably as well will find it very challenging if you think in this manner. Because out there in the world, the world has its hand on us again. But we are called to take this presence of Christ into the world, to be his body, to be his blood poured out in love for others. What a privilege that is, and what a challenge. I am mindful of a great contemplative monk named Brother Lawrence. I've shared his story on other occasions. He had this in spades. It was a gift God gave him to do that, to practice the presence of God in the everyday world, that everyday crazy world we're called back in which to live. And he was a monk some centuries ago in a very lowly station in the monastery, in the kitchen, with the pots. And at the mealtimes, it was quite hectic and busy there in the monastery kitchen, and everyone shouting to him, "Brother Lawrence, Brother Lawrence, Brother Lawrence." And he said of that moment, "Those moments were so holy with the presence of God that it was as if with every Brother Lawrence he heard, he was kneeling at the altar of God to receive the Blessed Sacrament." Wow. That is a completion of worship, to be able to take that step. John, in his gospel, talks about the feeding of the 5,000, as all the gospels do, but he has this wonderful image there at the end of the meal. And the image is, he tells the disciples, "Has everyone been fed?" "Yep, everyone has had all they can eat from those 5 loaves and a few fish." And he says, "Well, go gather the leftovers." And he gives to each of them a basket. And the kind of basket, according to the Greek language, is one that stands about that tall. We got baskets like that down in New Orleans, where I grew up. It holds the big 8-foot-long French bread loaves used for poor boys. I've seen that in some of the restaurants. That's the kind of basket he gave each of them. He said, "Gather the leftovers." And they gathered. The baskets were overflowing with bread. Why? Why not just leave it for the birds? But is it not an image of what we're called to be, taking what we have received, the spread of life, and to bring it to the world, the abundance of what we have enjoyed? I want to ask you a question now. As you listen to me talk of my own experience and bring your experience to this as well, what do you hear me sharing with you? Did you hear me share the complex sacramental theology of the church when it comes to this meal, with such terms as consubstantiation and transubstantiation? Did you hear me lay out the proper liturgical practices we are to follow? or the many steps you must do in order to be truly ready to receive this sacrament. Did you hear me do any of that? What did you hear me do? I shared with you my experience of what God shares with me at His table. Isn't that true for you as well? You see, it starts with the experience of the God who is present in this meal for us. That's where it starts. Jesus in the upper room, He didn't lay out a theology of Holy Communion for them. He didn't enter into all the great discussions over the many centuries of how to do this meal. He didn't lay out, okay, did you do the five steps in order to be truly prepared for celebrating this meal? Didn't do that. He simply surprised them, really. Surprised them with His presence. They partook of it. They were changed. The doctrine of our church, the liturgical practices, all of that rich tradition has its place. But it's really kind of a foundation on which our experience stands. It helps us at least articulate more clearly that experience, to understand it more fully, perhaps even to invite us into a deeper place with our experience of God in this holy meal. It has its place. But it doesn't begin there. Now, if you're as old as me, you've lived through some church. And living through some church in this area means you've seen a lot of conversation about Holy Communion, perhaps, along the way. And it is amazing how when we don't start with this rich experience of God with us, making us one, when we just start with the doctrine, or how we do it, or how we should do it, how we get short-circuited. So we never experience the fullness of the life that God wants to share with us. Can you believe it? It's 500 years and Lutherans and Catholics still haven't figured out how to commune at the same table. God is scratching His head. For the Lutheran family, can you believe it that Missouri Synod Lutherans and ELCA Lutherans find disagreements keeping us apart in this matter? Can you believe it that this church, this congregation, probably at one time in its past, probably had a few conversations, let's say, about how often to do Holy Communion, how old you had to be, and things like that. Whenever we get trapped in those kind of things, making distinctions between who's in and who's not and all the other distinctions, we're short-circuiting what God wants to give. And you know what happens when you short-circuit something? You flip the switch, the electricity gets short-circuited. It doesn't reach the light. It blows the fuse. It pops the bulb. It doesn't give the light of Christ and His love. We are invited to experience, above all, the deep mystery of God's presence for us in this holy meal. And it is a presence that calls us to be one with a very gentle love. A few moments ago, you heard the beautiful story from John of the upper room, how Jesus washed the disciples' feet. Now, there are folks who are puzzled. Like, John, you have these beautiful chapters, 13 and all the way through 17 in the upper room. And yet in all of that, you never talk about the Lord's Supper. You never talk about how He took the bread and the wine and gave us the gift of Himself. John, why didn't you talk about that like the other Gospels do? Well, my sense is that John, writing many years after the other Gospels, he knows we know that story, but he's been around long enough to see us short-circuit the meaning of the story. He says, I want to call you back to the full meaning of what it means to be the body of Christ at the table of the Lord. What it means to have servant love. What it means to lay down your life for your friends as Jesus did upon the cross. For the Christ who gives His life on the cross, He stretches those arms out And he gathers us all in, no distinctions. This is the mystery of Christ, the mystery of God's presence in this holy meal. Now, just a few words on simplicity. When Jesus does theology or profound teaching, his preference is simplicity. He always wants it simple, so simple, especially on the really big things that even a child can understand. Tonight we welcome children to the table of the Lord. For the last 3 weeks, Pastor Bill has been meeting with families in the garden room, not to cram it all into their head, but to begin to open them up to the experience of God's presence in this meal for them. And I got to peek in at times on what they were doing. And what a joy it was to see moms and dads and even grandparents with their children of all ages experiencing things and learning things and seeing moms and dads come out and say, "Wow, I experienced something I hadn't experienced before. I learned something I did not know before with my children." It's exactly what God is up to in this meal. Jesus wants it so simple that even a child can understand. In fact, sometimes I think children get it quicker than us adults. And it's as simple as this. These words are all we need to hold on to know the fullness of God's grace and truth for us. Jesus giving us the bread that is his body. And he says, "This is my body, and it's given for you." Did you get that? Was that too hard? If you're still trying to get it, I'll say it again, just like Jesus did. That's how Jesus does it. Good Hebrew style. You say it once and then you say it again. Only this time he says, "This is my blood," as he gives us the wine. "This is my blood given for you." And if you listen closely, he adds, "And not just for you, but for the whole world. For everyone's forgiveness and life." That's the call again to go and share. Two words before us tonight: simplicity and mystery that invite us into the presence of the God who is grace and truth for us. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. For our hymn, you may remain seated as we meditate upon this mystery. Thank you.
prayer this evening is taken from and inspired by a traditional prayer from the festival of the Passover. The response to each intercession is the word Deyenu. This word means it would have been enough. If God had created us and not revealed himself in all his marvelous works, if God had revealed himself and not made a covenant with his people, if God had made a covenant with his people and not breathed his spirit into us, if God had breathed his spirit into us and not shared with us his love, if God had shared his love with us and not watched over us when we strayed from him, if God had watched over us when we strayed from him and not delivered us from the bonds of slavery, if God had delivered us from the bonds of slavery and not led us into a land of freedom, if God had led us into a land of freedom and not sent us holy men and women to speak to us of his love, if God had sent us holy men and women to speak to us of his love and not promised us a Savior, if God had sent us Jesus, his own beloved Son, and had he not become our very brother, if Jesus had become our very brother and not shared our joy and sorrows, our laughter and tears, if Jesus had shared our life and not taught us how to love and to forgive and to serve each other, if Jesus had taught us how to love and to forgive and to serve each other, and had not left us this Holy Supper as a reminder of his love and a sign of his presence, if Jesus had left us this Holy Supper as a reminder of his love and a sign of his presence, and not called us to carry on his work in the world, but as it is, Father, your Son, Jesus, has revealed your love for us. His whole life, his death, and his resurrection from the dead testify to your deep mercy and compassion. Therefore, Father, we bless and thank you. We praise and worship you with all creation, for you are worthy of our worship and beyond all the praises of our hearts. To you and to your Son, Jesus, and to the Holy Spirit belongs all glory, now and forever. Amen. Now our service continues as we recognize and celebrate our candidates for First Communion. And as I say their names, I would ask that they line up over here, beginning on the end there. And as the children come forward, parents, baptismal sponsors, godparents, siblings, you're invited to gather behind them while they're standing at the altar rail. Calvin Castile. Logan Strong. Haven Franzen. Kyler Fraley. Cooper Grimm and Damon Grimm. Bradley Cameret, We'll start on this side now. Gabriel Kale. Bailey Lang. Macy Miles and Marissa Miles. Dax Nelson. Jocelyn Rowley. And Kane Wiegert. These young people have recently been instructed in the beliefs of our church about Holy Communion. They have learned that it is God's gift of life and forgiveness to us. They have learned that it is Christ's body and blood given and shed for the forgiveness of our sins. They have learned about its connections to the Passover story when the Israelites were set free from slavery. They have learned that it is God providing for our daily needs, just as He does in so many ways. They have learned that Christ is present with us as we, let's see it, receive it. And tonight, we celebrate this milestone with them as they receive this gift for the first time. And we will ask God's blessing over them.
To the parents, in holy baptism, you presented these sons and daughters to be made part of the body of Christ. In so doing, you made important promises to bring them to worship, to receive His body and blood, to teach them important articles of faith, including the Lord's Prayer and the Ten Commandments, and to support them as they grow as followers of Christ. Do you promise to continue in these efforts to support their growth in the body of Christ? Then say, we do with God's help. You may. Candidates are kneeling. I invite you to place. Yes.
On the children.
The scriptures tell us of two disciples on the way to Emmaus and how the risen Lord was revealed to them in the breaking of the bread. As with those disciples, warm the hearts of these children with your presence and may the fragrance of your grace remain with them as they continue their journeys, loving their neighbors as themselves and seeking to know you and to share you. Continue to reveal your truth and wisdom to them as they come to this welcome table each week. Amen.
And to make things official, I'm going to go down the line before the closing prayer. I'm going to go down the line and present each of them with their certificate for First Communion. Thank you. Let us pray. Lord, in the sacred meal we share this night comes forgiveness and new life. May it be always a time for us to have our eyes opened to your presence and goodness. May we burn with the knowledge and trust in your saving work for all of creation. In the name of Jesus, who gives his body and his blood for us. Amen. I think this achievement and milestone in their life is certainly worth our applause.
Congratulations, Robert. Congratulations, David. Congratulations.
Welcome to the table.
Invite the families to make their way back to their seats, and we will prepare for our offering.
Welcome you to the table.
Congratulations.
Welcome you to the table.
I have a home, eternal home, but for now I walk this broken world. You walked it first, you know our pain, but you show hope can rise again from the grave. Abide with me, abide with me, don't let me go, and don't let go, walk with me.
Sing for joy, abide with me.
Pray our Savior's prayer. Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Dearest Jesus, breathe your Spirit upon us and upon this bread and cup. Carry us in your arms from death to life, that we may live as your chosen ones, clothed in the righteousness of Christ. Please join me in the prayer. Lord Jesus, in a wonderful sacrament, you strengthen us with the saving power of your suffering, death, and resurrection. May this sacrament of your body and blood so work in us that the fruits of your redemption will show forth in the way we live. For you live and reign with the Father and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
My God, why have you forsaken me? Why are you so far from helping me, from the words of my groaning? Oh, my God, I cry by day, but you do not answer, and by night, but find no rest. Yet, you are holy, enthroned on the praises of Israel. In you, our ancestors trusted. They trusted, and you delivered them. To you they cried and were saved. In you they trusted and were not put to shame. But I am a worm and not human, scorned by others and despised by the people. All who see me mock at me. They make mouths at me. They shake their heads. Commit your cause to the Lord. Let him deliver. Let him rescue the one in whom he delights. Yet it was you who took me from the womb. You kept me safe on my mother's breast. On you I was cast from my birth. And since my mother bore me, you have been my God. Do not be far from me, for trouble is near, and there is no one to help. Many bulls encircle me. Strong bulls of Bashan surround me. They open wide their mouths at me like a ravening and roaring lion. I am poured out like water, and all my bones are out of joint. My heart is like wax. It is melted within my breast. My mouth is dried up like a potsherd, and my tongue sticks to my jaws. You lay me in the dust of death, for dogs are all around me. A company of evildoers encircles me. My hands and feet have shriveled. I can count all my bones. They stare and gloat over me. They divide my clothes among themselves, and for my clothing they cast lots. But you, O Lord, do not be far away. O my help, come quickly to my aid. Deliver my soul from the sword, my life from the power of the dog. Save me from the mouth of the lion. From the horns of the wild oxen you have rescued me. I will tell of your name to my brothers and sisters. In the midst of the congregation, I will praise you. You who fear the Lord, praise him. All you offering of Jacob, glorify him. Stand in awe of him, all you offspring of Israel. For he did not despise or abhor the affliction of the afflicted. He did not hide his face from me, but heard when I cried to him. From you comes my praise in the great congregation. My vows I will pay before those who fear him. The poor shall eat and be satisfied. Those who seek him shall praise the Lord. May your hearts live forever. All the ends of the earth shall remember and turn to the Lord, and all the families of the nations shall worship before him. For dominion belongs to the Lord, and he rules over the nations. To him, indeed, shall all who sleep in the earth bow down. Before him shall bow all who go down to the dust. And I shall live for him. Posterity will serve him. Future generations will be told about the Lord and proclaim his deliverance to a people yet unborn, saying that he has done it.
Thank you for worshiping with us at St. Paul's Lutheran Church. For more information about our church, to listen to previous episodes, or to find our Facebook and Twitter pages, please go to www.stpaulsgi.com.